Hello, this is Maxwell, your editor-in-chief of Underneath It All, a Nine Inch Nails podcast. Today on the show, we have Karen interviewing Richard Patrick, formerly of Nine Inch Nails and currently of Filter. We hope you enjoy the episode, and remember, you can find us on iTunes and at underneathitall.org.
Let's see. I have a lot of questions here. I don't know if you have a whole lot of time, so you need to go at any point,
I'll try and be brief in my answers. I have a tendency to kind of ramble.
But see, I like that though, because then interesting things come out. One would hope, anyway. Alrighty, so let's just start right at the beginning, I guess. Growing up, what inspired you to pick up a guitar? Was there any particular musician who inspired you? You just thought guitars are awesome.
I remember thinking Keith Richards was awesome. But I remember hearing the guitar on my dad's stereo and just being like, man, that sounds awesome. Just the chords and, the actual visceral experience of just having an amplifier tuned up. The guitar! I remember Jimi Hendrix and just feedback it's one of those things. I just discovered it, early on. And I remember actually my dad used to play the Neil Diamond record Hot August Nights.
Oh, really?
it's a live record. So he's, Neil Diamond would go, take it away, Richie. His guitar player was named Richie, and I just remember thinking to myself, well, my name's Richie, so I would imagine what it was like to play guitar, and just always loved it.
So if that guy's guitar player had been named Donald, your whole life could have turned out totally differently.
Maybe.
Were you formally trained to play the guitar, or like a lot of people, just kind of, were you self-taught?
I just picked it up. I really liked just making crazy noises on it, like just feedback and, I loved playing songs, and then at a certain point, I just remember it being kind of, I don't know how to describe it. It just seemed like it was an element that could either work with the song or kind of be the song. And I just loved it.
I have some general questions. Well, I have some questions about your time in Nine Inch Nails and then leading into Filter. So I'm kind of going chronologically.
Right.
The story online, and I don't know how true this is, the story online is that you and Trent Reznor met by chance in a record store in Cleveland, and that led to you becoming part of Nine Inch Nails. However, I've seen other stories that you actually met earlier than that. So how did you guys actually meet?
Well, it was really simple. There was this band called the Exotic Birds, and the drum teacher from that band, the drummer of that band, the Exotic Birds, was the drum teacher for my drummer named Dave Soleil in my little band in high school called The Act.
Right.
And it was a very alternative, new wave kind of, we played The Cure and U2 and, just stuff like that. And they needed an opening act with very few inputs. And I had, my amplifier and my mic, and we had a bass, and Dave was going to play Tom Freer's drums. And the band that, had that my drummer's drum teacher also had Trent Reznor in it.
Right.
And that was the Exotic Birds. So we opened up for the Exotic Birds. And that's how I met Trent.
So the story of you guys meeting in a record store, reaching for the same Skinny Puppy CD, is just a complete urban legend.
Reaching for the same Skinny Puppy record. Yeah, that's an urban legend. That's totally an urban legend.
Oh, well, we've,
I'm sorry to take it to a level of just kind of you know, it's very unromantic the way we met. It was just like, you know, Cleveland's a really small town. This is what I'll say. You know, Cleveland's a really small town. And, you know, I was an eager kid to, you know, get into the scene, start playing my music when I was really young. And Trent was in the Exotic Birds. And sooner or later, you know, you meet these guys. And at one point, I remember going to Pi Keyboards and Audio, where Trent worked and where Frank Vale worked and some other people. And I just remember, you know, we were talking. He goes, my manager came in here. You know, my manager came in here and goes, hey, Trent, your little brother's over there. Because we looked exactly alike when we were younger.
That's funny.
He's like, hey, Trent, your little brother's in here. Your teenage brother's in here. And Trent's like, oh, really? That's cool. Oh, wait, I don't have a little brother. You know, and so we were just talking. And there was a couple times when I remember when he quit the Exotic Birds, it was like it was a big deal because, you know, Andy was really leaning on Trent pretty heavily to be in it. And, you know, it was quite the big deal in the music community out there. And Trent just kind of disappeared. He locked himself into a studio called The Right Tracks, and he was working on demos. And then he invited me down even for that to do, like, they taught a class on Saturdays. And, you know, I went in there with my new song and, you know, tried to do it in 15 seconds. And Trent played me an early, early version of Down In It. And it was rap. And I was like, wow, that's fucking hip hop. Wow, you're really going out there. Like, you're getting pretty far away. And he's, yeah, man, that's what I'm doing. And then, like, that was it for, like, another 6 months or something. And then I was picking up something that was broken at a repair shop. Something was broken in my amplifier. Something had, you know, I needed new tubes in it or something. And here's Trent again. Trent, I heard you got a record deal. He goes, yep, dude. Signed. I just remember he's like, yep, signed to TVT Records. I'm like, wow, you actually signed a record. Like, that happens? Like, that can actually happen? He's like, yep. And it was just like, wow, so you're really going to fucking put a record out? He's like, yep. I'm like, wow. And he had seen me in this other little funny band that we had just done as a joke called Collapse. But this time I had actually seen Trent and I went to Skinny Puppy together too. It's like one of the first times I saw like Skinny Puppy like live, and it's like, holy shit, these guys are fucking really intense. So industrial music is like, you know, like I had kind of gotten familiar with Al Jorgensen, you know, with Ministry. And I remember we were at Fantasy Nightclub. To interrupt that story, I'm going to put in another story. We were at the Fantasy Nightclub, and Trent's like, you see that guy, this band, the Revolting Cox. I'm like, wow, what the fuck is this? And they're like, we need instruments. These guys showed up in a van, and it looks like they're all on acid, and like they have literally nothing but a tape deck. They have a 4-track tape deck. And, you know, they're like, we need stuff. We need something to play drums on. I think they had their own like snare drum, and like they needed a kick drum, and like it's like really funny. So I brought my guitar, and they were like, Rich, do you really want them to use your guitar? And I'm like, actually, no. And Al was
because you'll never get it back, right?
I'll never see it again. And but Al was literally on stage arguing with like Chris Conley that, You know, we should trip on acid. And Chris is like, no, I'm not doing that again, Al. I'm not gonna, you know. And I just remember like, oh my God, like that's real. And Trent's like, you see that guy, Al Jorgensen? He's my idol. And,
right.
You know, because of with sympathy and stuff like that. And so then, Trent was at the repair shop, and he had kind of done most of Pretty Hate Machine. And it was, you know, I was in this band Collapse, and I was like way different. I was like really like locked into industrial music and really into like, you know, being, you know, like, you know, way more like way more heavy and mean and, you know, fucking, you know, pissed and real, you know, and just, you know, reflective of who we were. I mean, my God, we were just, we lived in Cleveland, Ohio. It was just so, there was just nothing going on. I mean, like,
yeah, I lived in Albany for a while, so I can relate, kind of a similar vibe.
Yeah, it was just
vibe.
So depressing, and we were just like, how the fuck do we get out of here? And, you know, and it was just, so Trent had locked down this deal with TVT, and he was like, I'm putting a band together. You want to go on tour? I'm like, yeah, fuck yeah, anything to get out of here, like, you know. And he, and that's how I got into it. It was, he's like, I saw you in Collapse and you look really fucking different. Like, you're way more into, like, you're way more intense. I was like, yeah, well, you know, I'm just trying to get out of here, you know, that kind of thing. And he was like, well, we're going to go on the road. Would you be interested in going? I was like, yeah.
Well, at that point in time, could he have been like, you know, we're going to go on the road with our Partridge Family cover band? And you would have been like, yeah, let's get out of here.
No, I mean, everyone kind of knew, like, if there's someone who's going to break out of this town, if there's someone that's actually literally going to do it, it's going to be Trent, you know? And
oh, really?
Everyone was, even like old girlfriends or something would just be like, you know, that guy's really going to make it though. And you were like, he's going to get out of here. Like, there was something about the way he was just so fucking determined. And he's like, you know, I remember talking to him on the phone. He was just like, we're going to have to get a record deal. We have to get a record deal. And I'm like, why not? Why? I guess, you know, people would say like only 1 in 10,000 bands get signed. And of those 1 in 10,000 bands, you know, only, you know, 1 of 25 bands has a hit on the radio. And of that 25 bands that has a hit on the radio, there's, you know, they only really connect. There's only like 5 bands that from that connect, you know. It's just so, like, people we were hanging out with back then were just so goddamn depressing and like, there was no optimism. It's just like there was a land devoid of optimism.
Right.
And then, like, I think a week later, he was like, hey, I'm just hanging out of my house. I'm going to do some laundry. You want to come over here and listen to some of the record? And I was like, all right. So we went to, like, some coin-operated laundry facility, and he had this car. And he played the Adrian Sherwood version of Down In It. And then he played me Head Like a Hole. And I was like, well, that's absolutely fucking awesome. And this is when he had pretty much finished up the record, and I was like, this is awesome. I was like, this is fucking awesome music. It's fucking awesome. And internally, I wasn't just like, no, it wasn't the Partridge Family thing. It wasn't like, I'll just do anything. It was like, no, this was, I knew going into it that like Trent had something to say, and there was going to be this, and it was something reputable. It was something that I was into. I was into industrial music at the time. I was really into electronics. I was into the angry electronic sounding world, you know, the not Kraftwerks and Depeche Mode necessarily, not that those guys are bad, but not Information Society, which was a big band back then, you know, not like pop, but like mean, you know, and intense, like Ministry and Skinny Puppy. But Trent had the songwriting of, you know, of traditional songwriting that, you know, like whatever, the Rolling Stones or the Beatles. I mean, it's the same kind of verse, chorus, bridge, you know, breakdown, you know, that kind of thing. And so he had all those components, and I knew, like, man, this guy's absolutely got it going on. And Down In It's one of those songs that still today, it doesn't, it sounds timeless, you know,
Yeah, it's really hard to believe that those songs, The Head Like a Hole and Down In It especially, were recorded, what, 25 years ago now? It's kind of scary.
Yeah, and I had just seen them. I just saw them live at Leeds, the Leeds and Reading and they played down in it, and it was awesome. And it was just like, wow, it's crystal clear.
Now, I could see at that time, like, if you're trying to look for a way to kind of get out of Cleveland and also do it with the sort of heavy, visceral music, after hearing Head Like a Hole, you could be like, okay, I'm there.
You know, a song that kind of changed my life was, like, Stigmata. Like, my friend, because I had just gotten turned down from a record contract because I was way too, like, U2-y. I loved the digital delay with... the Stratocaster, and, you know, it's like, dude, you can't literally just use the thing. You got to fucking stand on your own two feet. And so my friend, like, came, I would just remember being really downtrodden, like, man, I fucking hate you too. And, you know, I was the age of like 17 or something. And my friend came in with the Land of Rape and Honey and was like, check this out. And, you know, it's like, holy shit, it's electronic. The guy's distorting his vocals on purpose, like on purpose, you know? And, that was like the turning point in a lot of us, because we were like, this guy's using a drum machine and like possibly a guitar, and there's no bass, you know? And if there is, you can't tell. It's just a bass synth. And, you know, and it was just like, that's the kind of shit that, you know, that's the kind of originality that you can do in the recording studio. And just kind of, you know, and I heard stories like, you know, I was just like, he was just like completely, he had just kind of gone away from With Sympathy and all that stuff and just went into this like heavy, mean fucking album. And Land of Rape and Honey was like just a gigantic, huge thing to us.
Right.
Yeah, and then like 1989 and 1988, I mean, that's when, you know, Mind is a terrible thing to taste, and you're sitting there watching it, and you're just like, this is possible. You know, someone can fucking be completely out of their minds, but as long as they have, and again, that's a hit song. I mean, Stigmata is like one of those songs. It's got like a beginning and an ending and a middle and choruses, and it works like a great song. You know, it's not just, you know, just an endless loop of drum machine, you know, stuff. Like, there was a lot of bands out there at the time that were like, you know, just like, you know, you can tell they just turned on the tape deck and just recorded and, you know, and had no purpose. It was like the Boredoms, you know what I mean? It's like, it's really great, and I'm glad you recorded a bunch of static, and yes, we're all impressed, and it's an amazing artistic statement, but it's never going to connect because it's just so far out there, you can't really, there's nothing to it. And that's the thing, Trent, you know, made that like a, he put, you know, the verses and the choruses, he had the songwriting in there. So it was just, you know, it was really
right.
Awesome.
So, okay, so you'd started playing with Nine Inch Nails, and Trent has said many times that in the really early days, a lot of the crowds you guys played for were actually pretty hostile. Like, they wanted something else, they didn't know what you were, and they weren't sure they liked it. Was that something that kind of got to you at the time, that was irritating, maybe?
I don't know. I mean, you know, I mean, maybe that was a couple of weeks. But, I mean, you know, we went on tour with the Jesus and Mary Chain and like, Peter Murphy. And we just, you know, Trent would just be like, fuck this show, you know, and let's drink, you know. And we would just get drunk and throw shit at each other. And then he'd, like, push me, and I'd fall in. The crowd would react, like, holy shit, look at these guys. And then it turned into just, like, the more chaos that we could create, the more entertained the audience was. And we were just, by the end of like the week, you know, that 2 week period where crowds weren't necessarily into us or whatever, if that even happened, I don't even remember that happening, to be honest with you. You know, by 3 or 4 months later, we were on our own headlining tour, fucking throwing each other around the stage. And we was, you know, sold out clubs all over the US, you know, like,
right. We may have gotten the impression from interviews that period was longer than it was, because probably Trent dwells on it. He's like, there was this one period of time when people didn't like us, and it sucked.
I mean, honestly, I do not remember that. I mean, I remember like, fuck, look at all these people lined up for the show. Like, it was like instant. It was just like, it was like, yeah, we maybe in front of Peter Murphy, there was a few shows that was like, oh, this sucks. They were expecting, Peter Murphy to come out and be all Mr. New Wave guy and kind of sophisticated at that point. And we're just like covered in cornstarch, drunk, throwing each other around the stage. Those shows, I guess those early tours, I mean, it was, I don't remember, like Lollapalooza, there was a couple moments where it was like, do these guys get it? Does anyone, like, you know, do these people understand us? There was a couple moments on Lollapalooza, but by the end of Lollapalooza, Head Like a Hole was like a huge hit, and it was on MTV. So like any kind of hostility towards us, even on Lollapalooza, was just gone by the end of it. You know what I mean? To me, it was like, it was a phenomenon, like, and just kept getting bigger and bigger and bigger, you know?
Right.
And still,
and speaking of, it's still getting bigger. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I feel like I keep interrupting you. I'm used to doing
interviews
right. in person.
That's so all right.
It's kind of new experience for me, but, now, obviously, you guys used to roughhouse a lot on stage, to put it mildly.
Yeah.
Back in those days, I mean, were you excited to kind of get on stage and beat each other up? Or were you thinking in the back of your mind, you know, one day we might kill each other, like by accident?
Well, I was already, like, counting my bruises. Like, I was already like, Jesus Christ. Like there was this one time where my knees really got fucked up and I was like, dude, he tackles me at the same time every song. I try and play the guitar part, you know, to sin, and he comes over and tackles. He's like, yeah, but that's just because, I just remember John Malm like, that's just because he's really into it. And it's like, it's driven by the music. And by, I'm like, yeah, but dude, I mean, at some point, am I going to go to the hospital and get these looked at? Like, you know, like it was one of those things. But when you're 20, you're made of rubber. I mean, you bruise for like a week, but then it's just gone. You know what I mean? Like, if you were to tackle me now, I think things would probably be a little different, but
you wouldn't be as keen on it.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think he later on hurt like Robin Fink. And I think he started realizing like maybe the mic stand shouldn't be flung in the air. I mean, it is, it's like that could kill somebody. It hit Podboy in the head and almost killed him. And he stayed and finished the set. And that's the kind of shit we used to do, though. Like, everything for the show, everything for that show. Like, we're going to go on stage for the last time. Let's go kill it and just be as insane as possible. And that was the key, really. And I still hold that today at my concerts. I mean, I'm just, by the end of, my song Self-Inflicted or something like that, I'm three screams away from blowing out my voice forever. And and it's, you have to make that kind of sacrifice, and that's what made NIN so amazing in the beginning too. It's the thing,
right? So even when you left in Form Filter, that's kind of a principle that sort of unites the two, that sort of commitment to that night's performance. So.
Yeah, you have to fully commit and go as fucking off as you possibly can. I mean, that's what I grabbed from. That's what I took from Nine Inch Nails, is that like you have to go as extreme as possible, like as heavy and as fucking intense as possible.
Okay, on a slightly different track, I recently watched that documentary they made about Nine Inch Nails, Nine Inch Nails and the Industrial Uprising, where...
Yeah, I want to fucking sue that director.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I if I saw that director face-to-face, I'd fucking punch him in the face, because it was absolutely a complete shine job by those guys, and... I would fucking deck him. I would punch him so hard he'd never wake up. Yeah.
What, you didn't like the edits they used, or I'm just curious what?
No, the edit was totally shit. He did not tell me it was a Nine Inch Nails interview. He told me it was just the interview for the industrial uprising and industrial music. And
oh, that's yeah, not nice.
They fucking lied out their ass to fucking do that. They had no moral compass on what they were doing at all. And Chris and I, when we saw it, we were like, this is the worst fucking portrayal of our involvement. I was like, this is absolutely, yeah, that guy, he's got fucking crosshairs on his back. If I ever see that motherfucker, I'm fucking.
Gotcha. Wow. All right. In that case, I'm going to gloss over the question I had, because obviously it was taken in an interview that was given under duress. So I don't want to hold you responsible for
that. No, that guy was fishing for something. I was like, dude, are we going to sit here and talk about Nine Inch Nails? Because I'm not prepared to do, like, I don't know why we're doing this. Like, what, you know, and then after the interview, they go, well, you know, we've had a lot of that. It was an American film crew doing the bidding for a German documentary. The director wasn't even there. And like, they had literally just a film crew, and the guy had all these questions. And I'm like, I don't understand. What is this interview for? Why am I being filmed? Are we talking about industrial music, or are we talking about Nine Inch Nails? And he was just like, well, it says right here, industrial revolution. I'm like, okay, well, why did I just spend a lot of time answering questions about Nine Inch Nails?
And yeah, so it was really messed up.
That was my first lesson in, you know, people are shit, and they'll fuck you, and you have to watch out. You have to watch your back, you know. And that guy's got to watch his back now for the rest of his life.
Yeah, I don't doubt it. I bet a lot of people are pissed at him now. Okay, so let's move on to something hopefully slightly more pleasant.
I had never listened to Nine Inch Nails after I left. Like, they're asking me questions about all these records, and I'm like, I've never heard it. I never heard The Downward Spiral until a couple of years ago.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I mean, I have so much other stuff to do with my life. You know what I mean? And it's like, this guy's bringing up stuff, and I'm just like, I don't know. Have you talked to Trent? Why don't you go interview Trent? Does Trent know about this? I'm like, are you going to interview Trent? Because if you want to interview Trent, go interview Trent. But, you know, what is this? My band's called Filter, and we went platinum, and I've had a lot of success in industrial. And, like, why are you making me have to say that? Like, why am I here talking about my band like it's, like I'm not here for that? You know, I'm here. If I'm talking about Trent, well, what's the – you know what I mean? It was a very fucked up interview, and that guy, like I said, he was just a total piece of shit.
But as long as you happen to mention that you didn't end up listening to The Downward Spiral until a couple of years ago, I mean, was that, had you been hearing about for years, like, oh, it's the masterwork, blah, blah, and when you finally heard it, were you kind of let down by it at all, or how did you feel about it?
Well, let me put it to you this way. For 3 or 4 years, I was on tour. And early on, I acquired the nickname Piggy. And when I left, Brian Leeskane called me up and goes, dude, Trent's up here at the Tate Mansion, just like where he wrote this song. He's like singing lyrics called Piggy and, you know, Piggy, you're not gonna hold me back or something like that. I'm like, oh no, like what? And he's like, yeah, he's like writing songs about you and stuff. And I'm like, oh fuck, that's not good. And so, like, you know, that's how I remember hearing about the song Piggy, and I was like, you know, I hear it, and you know, it kind of makes me sad that I put him through something. And I don't know if he'd ever really want to admit that I was, you know, my nickname was Piggy. I mean, I went and saw Skinny Puppy. I went and snuck in at a sound check, and Ogre got up there and was singing about, like, some white, like, you know, big, huge, fat, white-faced, you know, Piggy. And he was going, Piggy, painted face, white, Piggy. He was just doing all this stuff. And so I did the invitation for Trent when I came back that weekend, and that was like the first weekend I ever took acid or something. And like, I was telling him, I was like, man. And then I saw you know, I saw the Skinny Puppy sound check, and he was singing the song Piggy, and Trent's like, he's like, all right, Piggy, plug your guitar in, we got to play. And from then on, I was just kind of nicknamed Piggy. I actually fought it. I was like, don't call me Piggy. That's sad. I don't want to be Lord of the Flies. I don't want to be all fucking Lord of the Flies. I'm Piggy. He's like, oh, come on, shut up, Piggy. Piggy, are you pissed? You know, it was just like this common thing. And then I'd like fall down on stage and I'd come off stage and be like, Piggy, fall down. You know, and I just created this persona of like Piggy, the guitar player that, you know, didn't have much up and upstairs and like just kind of like, nah, Piggy, you know, just kind of walked around. It was just this like nickname that I acquired. And then I heard the song and I was like, oh, fuck, you know. And then I actually really listened to it again. I saw some clips of it live, and you know, it's, you know, I don't want my buddy to be pissed at me or anything, but you know, of course, you can interpret music any way you want, and you know, you can, you know, I'm sure he's got different meanings behind it and stuff like that. But I always kind of took that to heart, like, oh shit, I hope he doesn't truly hate my guts, you know, because that was a rough time. I mean, I was, you know, here I was, you know, I was, you know, I was 20, 25, 26. I had nothing going on other than what I had recorded on my own. And in Nine Inch Nails, Trent's first instrument is, you know, the keyboard. And then it's the studio. So it's like the studio, the keyboard, and maybe some guitar. And if he needs guitar, he can play it. You know what I mean? Because his guitar parts are really just like, he knows exactly what he wants. And so I came to him and I had this song, you know, this song, Hey Man, Nice Shot. And I'm like, what do you think? He's like, God, it's really good. It's like your boy Stabbing Westward stole your guitar riff and, you know, you should record that. So he helped me record Hey Man, Nice Shot. And I did it up there at the Tate House. And that demo kind of made its way to Warner Brothers through some friends of mine. Richard Bishop was the manager for Henry Rollins and people like that. And all of a sudden I had this offer, you know. And I just remember being just like super nervous because I was like, you know, if this offer is like what I think it is, and I should probably just focus on that because it was tough. I mean, I was 25, you know, we were both drinking all the time. Mm. I felt, you know, and the other thing was, is that like, I mean, you know, I was really poor. I mean, like really, really poor. I had no money. And I just remember the manager, you know, calling me up and he's like, hey, Rich, so you're not going by the house that much. And I'm like, yeah, I'm not going by the house that much. And he's like, well, what are you doing? I'm like, I'm just kind of working on music. And I offered Trent some music and I don't know, I feel like I just want to keep it. And he's like, yeah, well, you know, if you do any writing, we're going to go ahead and take all the publishing anyway, so, you know, you'll get credit, but you're not going to own anything. And I'm like, okay, that's not necessarily good.
I'm not sure I understand what's going on there. So, like, when you wrote Hey Man, Nice Shot, was there some talk of it being released, like, as a Nine Inch Nails song? Without me being...
It was like, Trent, he liked the guitar riff in Hey Man, Nice Shot, and he liked elements of it, but that's about as far as it went. Because the next day, the manager called me up and was like, "Yeah, if we use anything that you write, you're not going to own any of it." And I just being like, "That's completely unsatisfactory," because I had already kind of started receiving, you know, offers from Warner Brothers, and you know, they didn't know about this stuff. And then I'm like, well, you know, John, I'm so fucking poor and it's so expensive to live out here. And he goes, hey, I got a fix for that. And I'm like, okay. He goes, Trent and I, you know, kind of think this is a good idea. And, you know, there's this little, at the bottom of the hill down there off of Ciela, there's this little pizzeria. And you know how you want to get to know Los Angeles a little bit more? and you want some more
money.
Oh,
no, I think I see where this is going.
Yeah. And I went, so he goes, they need a driver, and you can, like, learn, you know, L.A., you know, gain a little responsibility, and, you know, and you'll make some money. Why don't you do that? You can, you know, that's how you make some money. And I'm like, holy shit. So now I've got, you know, this guy telling me, you know, that if you write anything for Nine Inch Nails, you're not going to have any ownership. You'll get credit, but not ownership. And if you really want to make some extra money, you should go down to this pizzeria and apply to be a driver.
And at that point, you're like, I think I'll get a record deal. Thank you very much.
I'm right. Like, and I just remember thinking to myself, like, you have no idea, like, what is going on with me at all. And I went, dude, you know what? I'm going to get a fucking record contract with Warner Brothers. And I think I'm going to go ahead and release a record, that filter record that I've always wanted to do. And he was like, really? Oh, really? You're going to go off and... And get a record contract. Really? I'm like, yeah. He's like, well, who are you talking to? I'm like, well, it's Warner Brothers. They're the first ones that have made an offer. And he's like, really? Over there at Warner Brothers? I'm kind of doing a caricature. So don't think, because I think it's funny now. But like, yeah. I just started, really? Who are you talking to over at Warner Brothers? And I was like, well, his name is Mike Austin. And his boss, he's, oh yeah, Mike Austin, sure, yeah, Mo Austin's son, I know all about him, yeah, and who's the president over there? I'm like, oh, I just met him yesterday, and his name is Lenny Warnker. Oh, so you really are talking to those guys. And I was like,
that's
yeah.
Pretty funny, like the slow realization that you
yeah,
actually,
like, and I'm like, and yeah. I'm like, dude, and I'm like, see, why would I want, like, here you guys are offering me a job to go work as a pizza boy, and there's potential behind me, you know, and needless to say, I mean, that song has generated like so much of a life for me, and you know, the band Filter has done so much for me, and you know, I'm forever grateful that kind of, you know, I had that opportunity, and I took it, and you know, and it was just that, it was just, you know, I don't have any resentments today, but like, it was just like that, telling a 26-year-old kid that, like, you know, you can play guitar and you can write and you can do some stuff, but you'll never have ownership and you'll never. And it was just like, who does that? Like, who, in my own band, like, you know, it's like, if you write, you have to have publishing. You have to have your own publishing number. You have to have your own publishing company. I don't want to have anything to do with it. You know, because you want people to, it's the right thing. You know, it's like yeah. If you take a picture and someone, you know, puts it out and all of a sudden they have the rights to it and you're the photographer. It's like, wait a minute, I took the picture of that and it's mine. You know what I mean? It's yeah. Intellectual property. And so, you know, to just kind of trying to pull that kind of shit on me. And it was just like, you know, and I know that that's not necessarily what, like, Nine Inch Nails fans want to hear, but that's kind of where it was. It wasn't even necessarily Trent or, and I didn't, it's not like I said, guess what, I've got a record contract with Warner Brothers, and like, you know, if you guys want to, you can make an offer, and you guys could be the people that, you know, that sign it to nothing, you know what I mean? But you know, they kind of wanted me to play guitar on the tour. And I'm looking back, it's like, you know what? I probably could have done both. And it could have been very prosperous for everybody. It could have been a good thing for everybody, but it was just so like, they just, I just don't know if they knew that, like I could do it too. You know what I mean? It was kind of like,
yeah, I don't think they knew what they had at that time.
Yeah. And I certainly don't blame them. I mean, again, I was just this crazy kid. I mean, Short Bus was like, it's two kids recording, you know, with a computer, and there's no attempt to make something shiny and beautiful. It's just like the most, you know, barbaric way to record something, drum machine, guitars. I mean, it's just like, whatever. We don't give a fuck. We're drinking. We're having a blast here. you know, and it was just like, that was the mentality behind it. It was just like, it was not supposed to be a beautiful, pristine thing. It was just supposed to be raw and crazy. And that's, you know, that's, I guess what, that's one of the things that people still love today. That album is just like, these crazy kids got a computer and they fucking went off and recorded this rock record, you know?
Well, at that time, when you were starting Filter, obviously it was going to be a very different band from Nine Inch Nails because you had tried a very different people. But, I mean, were there aspects of it, of like the Nine Inch Nails sound that you specifically were like, you know what, I don't want to do that thing that I was playing in Nine Inch Nails?
Well,
what aspects you specifically avoided?
Well, that's the thing. Lee Skang had just come from that camp. He had worked on the Prick record, and he had worked on it. I was like, dude, I kept trying to hamper him down, just like, dude, I'm sorry. That's a Trent. You pulled that from Trent, dude. We can't do it. We can't do it. You can't do that kind of stuff. We've got to sound original. We've got to sound different. We've got to sound like, you know. We had more, I mean, the guitar parts in general had more in common with, you know, with Nirvana and Soundgarden and you know, Pantera. Or Ministry. It was like that. Let's try and find, without being rock, let's try and find. So it was really difficult because I didn't want to, you know, I didn't want to just, you know, just be like, you know, Nine Inch Nails Part Two, you know, the solo guitar player. You know what I mean? I wanted it to be stand on its own 2 feet. At the same time, though, I was influenced by all the stuff that Trent was influenced at the time. You know, there's a lot of, you know, there was, you know, looking back on it, there was a point where I was just like, you know what, Brian, go fucking, I was like, Brian, you know, go crazy. Just do whatever you got to do. And it was the song Jurassitol. And I remember thinking to myself, I think we've got it. I think just, you know, the fact that my voice is different and the fact that, like, you know, I use way more guitars than him, you know, is okay. And like, we were stealing sounds from like Lenny Kravitz records, and we, you know, it was, we had our own like kind of attitude at the time. And I think even today, when I announced the song Jurassitol, I always go, this is about as close to, you know, sounding like Nine Inch Nails as possible, because we were using the same computers. We were using this, you know, similar, you know, the same design. We were doing a lot of the same things, and it was Lee Skang had actually learned a lot, and not necessarily from Trent, but he had also, you know, like, he was up to some crazy shit, you know, as well, some crazy tricks. And so we did a lot with feedback. We did a lot we took the guitar and just made these bizarre sounds with it, and like would, you know, grab like a tiny little bit of feedback and drop it down an octave and invert it, and, you know, and then take the pick scrape and scrape it and try and just, you know, it was art because we intended it. We wanted to have the sound of a pick scrape, and like, that's it. And that's our overdub. Leave us alone. You know what I mean? Like, we definitely wanted to have some of that, the anarchy in it. And I think, honestly, a lot of the anarchy within the sound design was kind of coming from more of the punk rock vibe than it was the Nine Inch Nails vibe.
Right.
But yeah, it was, you know, at first I was like, man, I don't want to ever talk about Trent. I was completely like, I told Warner Brothers, don't ever mention that I'm from Nine Inch Nails. And they, you know, to the best of their ability, they tried to do that. But, you know, at a certain point, the journalist goes, wait a minute, that's Richard from Filter. Put Nine Inch Nails guitar player way up at the top of it. You know, because you have to, as a journalist, you have to put in as many, you know, connections, period, so that more people read it. You know what I mean? So,
yeah.
Yeah.
I wrote for newspapers for 3 years, so I have an idea.
yeah, so you know. Yeah.
When you started, so during that time, when you first started, you know, playing shows as Filter, were you prepared to go from kind of being a member of the band to being the front man of your own band?
Nope.
Was that like a shock to the system?
Nope. I was not ready at all. I was absolutely not ready. I think my alcoholism had really kicked in at that point. And I just remember like thinking to myself, like, why are these guys bitching and moaning about their jobs, and they knew exactly what they were getting into when they joined this thing. You know what I mean? Like, the record was already on its way to gold when all these people were, you know what I mean, you know, getting into this thing. And I just remember, like, the soap opera aspect of, you know, of that, and just kind of always nursing a hangover and always trying to, like, you know, just handle, you know, the pressure of being the front man. And back then, I mean, I would drink before shows, and, you know, I look back and there was some really great concerts and it was really awesome. But, like, you know, it was never, it, you know, like now it's so easy to just, to be a performer. I mean, I feel like I'm in my prime. My voice is, you know, I can sing 14 shows in a row, and you know, I'm always at that razor's edge of going too far on my voice. And, you know, the audience last night was just as, you know, as awesome as the audience back in 1995, you know, it's still, I mean, you get out on the road and you've got all these people that are trying to, you know, listen to you, and you're this kind of this lunatic. And, you know, I remember being late on stage and, you know, and just being like, you know, I don't fucking care about this. You know, like, I just want to fucking have a good time. And and that's when it was like, wow, this is really getting out of hand. Like, you know, right. You know, cause everyone around you is like, how can I get what I want out of this? You know, and you're like, it doesn't really, we did the record with a drum machine. You're the drummer. Just play the drums. I mean, just play the part. Like, I don't know what to tell you, dude. Just play the drum. You know what I mean? It still goes on like that.
He just, like, we're not ready for rock star politics or whatever it was they were.
Yeah, I mean, especially because I was kind of reacting the other way towards the way when I was in Nine Inch Nails. I was kind of trying to bend over backwards and make people as happy as I possibly could. And like, you know, eventually it just was like, you know, it was like, are these people just, you know, I remember waking up and going, like, everybody's on a retainer. Everybody's being paid as much as they possibly could be paid without, like, you know, going into, like, you know, just some insane business plan. I remember thinking to myself, my guitar player is buying a house, you know, and he didn't do anything on the first record. He's getting ready to go buy a house because he's, you know, he's successful in this. And it was just like, it was a wild concept. And I just remember thinking, like, where's my house? You know, and so much of it had gone on to the road and just, you know, there's so much stuff. But yeah, eventually you look back and you go, okay, well, that was the right thing to do. And that is awesome. And that is great. But, you know, like, it was just wild because I was so far out of my own control that, like, I didn't have the wherewithal to go, like, get a house. I didn't have, I was just this, by the midnight, late 90s, I was like, my alcoholism was just like, it was the priority. So I would be like, hey, can I crash at the studio and just sleep on the floor? And you know what I mean? I didn't, you know, I wasn't, I mean, I had like an apartment or something, but I was all, there wasn't any kind of strategy for like tomorrow. You know, it was all about like,
right.
It was all about nursing the hangover today and writing songs and going on tour. And so being a band leader was a very difficult thing during those years. And then right around when I got sober, everything kind of cleared up and everything was easy, you know.
Right.
And especially now, like when I'm working with Johnny Radke, and he's this amazing guitar player, and it's just as even as it could be. It's just like, hey, dude, what you put in is what you get out, you know. And you know, and him and I just sit there and write these songs, and we it works, and we get them recorded, and then we put them out. And it you know, I mean, we put out records and wind up, you know, amazing label, and we go on tour and we play, and we're doing everything that we're supposed to do. And it's just like, yeah, that's easy. You know what I mean? Once you get to a point of clarity where, you know, you can understand everything, but, you know, kind of the takeaway things that I got from Nine Inch Nails was just like, the more chaos you brought into it, the more interesting it was. And so the more chaotic I made Filter, I thought the more interesting it was. But and that was true for many aspects, but at the same time, it was like, you know, it was difficult because, you know, people were, I think, getting the wrong impression of what they were in the band. And, you know, and, you know, and a lot of that was my, you know, ill communication. I just didn't have, you know, I just didn't have a clear vision of what I thought the band was. You know, I was like, is it a band? I mean, is it a band? Is it me? Gino put so much work into a title of record. So he was definitely an amazing, huge part of that.
Right.
And so, you know, that's the thing. That's why it's, you know, it's tough being the boss. And that's why, you know, I told Trent the last time I saw him, I'm like, I get it. You know, you can have it all. My empire is dirt. I'm like, I get it. He kind of nodded, you know, and he's like, yeah. I was like, yeah, I kind of understand that lyric. I know where you're coming from on that. It's like, there's only, you know, there's only a few times in your life where you literally just don't want to have to say no. And like, you know, you look into someone's eyes and you're just like, I'm sorry, just no, you know, like, I'm sorry, I just don't like your song, you know, sorry, you know, it's like, it, you know, it's killing the person inside. And, you know, you don't want to have to be the bearer of bad news. And it is like, it's all determined by opinion and taste and style. And it's like, all that stuff could be debated. But like, if you want me to work on your song, don't you want me to be inspired by it? Because I don't want to fucking work. Because I don't want to fucking work on it. You know what I mean? And having to say that those dreaded words is really, you know, it's one of those things. So it's once you become the boss and you start realizing that you're the first one there and the last one to leave, you're kind of like, holy shit, this is a lot. This is a lot more. You know, it's way more difficult than it looks.
Well, was I mean, to a certain extent.
And most of it is because people just think you're being mean. You know, most of it's like people just think you're being mean. You know, like even today, I'm like, hey, dude, go over here. You see that guitar pedal? It's broken. Get online. Go, you know, get in touch with my endorsement people. You know what I mean? Like you're still having to, like, you know, be the boss, and it sucks. You're like, I hate to say this, bro, but you're fired because you fucked this up and fucked that up, and I can't have this anymore. You know what I mean? So
right.
It's, you know, those realities are tough. And for this alcoholic, you know, not wanting to you know, to have to say no, you know, it was really made difficult to be a band leader. And I wasn't prepared back then. And now I actually like it a lot. So it's different.
Well, now that you're in obviously a much healthier place, do you still make music, though, that feels really, really raw and heavy and in a good way? there's some really great aggressive stuff on The Sun Comes Out Tonight. And I was just curious if that anger perhaps comes from a different place than it did when you were younger, maybe channeling different sort of feelings.
Well, you know, I'd hate to say it, but, you know, you can still get hurt, you know, like, I mean, as peaceful as I've been in the last, you know, 10 years, there's still a lot of things. There's still a lot of really bad things that can happen. And, you know, I don't have a gun. I don't have a revolver. I don't have a machine gun. I can't go and march into someone's house and shoot everybody up. I have to channel it somewhere, and it has to go into my music, you know? And, I've been to Iraq 3 times, you know, and there was a rocket attack, and I remember, like, get down, and, like, you know, you get down and you're lying face down in the sand of this base, and you're looking at Marines, and they're looking back at you, and they're like, we're gonna die, you know, and I just remember thinking to myself, nothing could be as bad as that, you know. So I just have to, like, for me, it's all about capturing the energy of being upset, and just you know, apparently it really just comes out when I'm singing. It's like, you know, I have to kind of get in there and really dig down deep and scream as hard as I can. And that's the point where I think the audience made that connection. In the very first time they heard my voice, like, came in and they shot stuff like that. I didn't really know that about myself. Like, it was that, like people were on the last record, The Trouble with Angels and Soldiers, the song Soldiers of Misfortune, they're like waiting for me to kind of lose it, like lose it emotionally and lose it. And so I didn't really have the ammunition to do that back then, but now I have like the life experience, not only from being a crazed, you know, teenager to a crazy 20-something, but you kind of have to have that. You've got to always remember where you came from, and that's kind of what I do. Is I just, you know, the heavy stuff, I have to represent the energy and the determination of like what it takes to just fucking lose your mind. You know, like you have to really, really tap into that. It's like, you know, I understand why method actors, like, they really, really get in there so they can, when they look in the mirror, they look back and they see the guy that they're, you know, they're portraying. And it's like, for me, it's like I have to get in there and have that kind of crazed, drunken rage, you know, in me, you know, just, I'm not a note for note perfect singer, but at the end of the song, I'm just going to, I don't have, you know, I don't have the melody for it to end perfectly, you know, and, you know, so I just scream as over the top as I can. And that's, I've known, there's been a couple of singers that I've noticed that do that, you know what I mean? That, mm-hmm. you know, Chad from Mudvayne, I saw a performance from them a long time ago, and he was just so determined to like destroy his voice. He was just like, I'm just going to kill my voice. Like he was, and like, that's kind of the, you know, that's the important thing to do. It's like, is to make that commitment that like, you know, that's what we were doing in industrial music. That's what we were trying to get to, that spot that was just so, on the verge of just, you know, just complete and utter, you know, insanity. Like literally, like I went insane for a couple seconds there. You know what I mean? Like.
Yeah.
You know.
All that said, I mean, are there ever days you feel tempted to kind of write ballads, do something that maybe sounds completely different from Filter, maybe as part of another project?
Well, I've done enough other projects. I did Army of Anyone.
Right.
I did The Damning Well. I really just like doing Filter. I mean, I really do at this point. I remember Trent was always talking about this thing called Tapeworm that he wanted me to sing on. I don't remember.
You're not serious, right? You're serious?
I remember he had this thing that he had years ago that he was, this thing called Tapeworm that he was wanted me to sing on.
Wow.
He was talking about something like, I got this project I'm doing. Maybe you could sing on something like that. That's the only other offer I've ever thought to myself I would probably take up.
Okay. So you're committed to Filter for the time being.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I love Filter. Take a picture, surprise. That's the other stuff that I do in Filter that's like completely different from like, Hey Man, Nice Shot and Self-Inflicted and What Do You Say and all that stuff, Tyrasitol. So Surprise is our new single. And I love that song. Have you heard our record? Sun Comes Up Tonight?
Yeah, I was actually listening. I was actually listening to it for most of today. So I don't know it well enough that I know that I correlate every song with the title yet. But I'm really enjoying it.
Yeah. So,
I just have a few more questions. In the past couple of years, I mean, you've been with Filter, you've been increasingly prolific. Do you think that's just a natural consequence of kind of being in a better place in your life and being more in control? Or does today's musical environment actually make it easier in some respects?
I'm still trying to figure out why you were laughing so hard when I said something about tapeworm.
Oh, no, just because it's kind of like become an ongoing joke in the Nine Inch Nails community. The trend to spend more time trying to answer questions about tapeworm than tapeworm. Like, he spent more time trying to talk about it, like answering questions about it, than he ever spent working on it. So it's kind of become like the joke project that never was. So it's
right.
Kind of like, so I would think to ask you as a joke. So, hey, were you involved with tapeworm? So for you just to volunteer that you might have been involved with tapeworm is kind of hilarious.
Well, yeah, it's funny because he was talking about doing something with a bunch of different singers.
No, I'm telling you, people are going to hear this and they're not going to believe that there's another side. There's yet more to the tapeworm story, the gift that keeps on giving.
I'm sorry.
No, it's amazing.
I'm kind of new to the Nine Inch Nails fans, I feel like, because. You know what I mean? I haven't really, you know what I mean? Like, there's always Nine Inch Nails fans at our shows, which is awesome, but I don't like sit around and talk about it that much.
Yeah, I know.
I do now because recently, you know, we've been communicating and stuff like that. And I cherish Trent's friendship, and, you know, I think it's been enough time that, you know, some of the stuff is actually pretty interesting. So why not talk about it, you know? But I don't want to be, you know, poor Trent with tapeworm. I don't want him getting like, shit, Richard Patrick just threw on another 10 questions for me. I don't want to have to to work off another interview doing that.
Well, I think people
to fend off questions about tapeworm. I'm sorry about that. I just remember he did at some point when he was talking about tapeworm.
Okay. I think with Nine Inch Nails fans, because of those long waits between albums, like, kind of developed this weird culture of making a big deal about things that really were not that big a deal. And tapeworm was one of those things that people just like to talk about, you know, what tapeworm might have been and things like that. So.
Right.
But I guess I'm getting a little off topic. Let's see. I mean, in recent interviews, you mentioned that you and Trent have been getting along lately after not really talking for a while. I mean, is there a sense of maybe friendly competition now between you two? Or is it more a case of you're both trying to do very different things?
Oh, man. Honestly, I think it's just about, like, having families and just, you know, I mean, shit, if it were a competition, I mean, you know, he's got an Oscar, he's got a sold out arena tour. I mean, you know, I think that he is absolutely, you know, cherishing every moment of what he's going through. At least he should be, you know. And I'm having a blast, you know, doing what I'm doing, and I'm just in clubs. I'm just rocking out, you know, 2,000 seaters, 3,000 seaters. And I'm just having a fucking great time doing that. So to me, it's like, at this point, it's like, I've never really been in a competition. I just always wanted to do what I wanted to do within music. You know what I mean? It's, for me, it's like, you know, I went platinum and I'm like, well, there you go. What's so fucking great about that? I'm still not happy. I went out and bought a nice car and I'm like, well, where's the happiness that comes along with any of this shit? You know? And I was fighting my demons with alcoholism and stuff like that. And, you know, so, like, as soon as I kind of made those, you know, those goals that are so important to you when you think are so important, you know, all that stuff, financial security, everything, it's like, you know, once you get there, you're kind of like, all right, well, what else is there in life? What else is there? And it's, you know, to me, the fact that I get to, you know, make a video for my second single on this new album is just, as, you know, the idea that I'm allowed to, like, take somebody else's money and make a short, you know, film with, you know, with ideas in my head. I mean, that's still just the most gratifying feeling, the fact that I'm allowed to, you know, turn on a new hard drive and you know, kick up a new version of Pro Tools and sit there and have a guitar and just make music. I mean, that's really just that's the whole thing, is being an artist. It's accomplishing, like, you know, 15 minutes ago, you know, when I started working on the song Surprise, I was like, you know, that morning it was not there. And then I went to work, you know, I went to my buddy's house to get together and write a song. And then the next day, there it is, you know, there was nothing. And then we created something, you know, beautiful out of nothing, and it sits in a hard drive and it's waiting for us to mix it. And you know what I mean? That blows my mind, you know, that, you know, Take a Picture was just a little tiny guitar part that I played, and then it blossomed into this song. I mean, I don't want to make this like sound, you know, when someone comes up to you and they go, you know that part in Take a Picture where you say, "Hey Dad, what do you think about your son now? And I'm like, "Yeah." And he goes, "Well, listen, my dad, you know, left me in a hotel room alone when I was 3, and that's what he did to me. You know, my dad just left me in a hotel room, and I was raised by foster, you know, parents." He's like, "You know, when I heard your song on the radio and I went and got it and I listened to it, it really helped me through resenting my natural father for doing that, you know, and I've forgiven him. And, you know, and it was your song that helped me to get there." And it's just like, I hear that every day. I hear some amazing story about how, you know, my music's affected someone, and to be, it's the most, you know, it's the most admirable, self-fulfilling, like self-affirming. I mean, as a musician, all I wanted to do was to touch people's hearts and to maybe make their day a little cooler, or just, you know, to have that happen, to someone just come up to me and just randomly say, like, "Man, your music really helps me. It really, really helps me." And I'm like, "Oh, that's awesome." You know, there was a kid online that, you know, he was like, "Hey dude, you know, Filter Guy, you know, my friend and I listened to you like over and over and over, and we would listen to you in Afghanistan. We were in the army, and we would listen to you when we were on ops in Afghanistan. And I got a call, we got separated, you know, we went to different areas of the army, and he was at a base and you were playing there." And he goes, "Dude, you're never going to believe Filter's here at the base playing." And he like called his friend, and his friend is like, "Wow, I can't believe that." And so he was like, "Well, my friend went off and he fought and he's dead." And that was the last time I talked to him, was when he was saying that he was, and he's like, "I've never heard that person. And in the years I've known him, I've never heard that person more happy than when he was at one of your concerts." So like, there are things in the world that are so much more above being competitive and being kind of like trying to outdo someone. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, I to tell you the truth, I almost regret using the term competition now, because that's really not what I meant. I meant like, do you two kind of inspire each other? Like, do you see each other doing a sort of project and then thinking, "Oh, maybe I might be interested in doing that," like that sort of thing. That was
do you see what I'm saying though about being a musician? That's what being a musician is all about. It's the fact that that someone, you know, has, you know, a record collection of every single Filter record and comes up and just wants to meet me, and I sign their record collection and it's all the Filter records, and you know, and they're just happy that I do what I do, which is wake up and be a dork, you know, with music and just, you know, and just enjoy screaming into a microphone. And that's what it's all about, you know? Yeah. So as far as inspiration, I think I pretty much got what I needed. You know what I mean?
Right.
be true to yourself. You know, try and break down some doors. That's the stuff that I got. That's the stuff that inspired me. You know, that was right. The stuff. It's like, we can actually get it.
Well, I have a little bit of a filter story. It's not as dramatic, but I guess I may as well.
Go for it.
I discovered Nine Inch Nails when I was like 11, so it's always going to have a special place in my heart for that reason. But when I was living in Albany, which is a very dreary city, very much like Cleveland, I was doing graphic design. I was in a job I didn't like at all. But my one friend at work lent me a title of record, and I remember there was like one weekend I just listened to that album over and over again and played video games, and I was like thinking, damn, this is an awesome album. And I remember at that time thinking, you know what? Albany sucks, but it's really not that bad. I've got cool music to listen to. And eventually I ended up getting out of that situation. So,
yeah.
One of millions of people who can share that little story. So,
and that's the whole thing. I mean, that's what I get out of music.
Right. You know, I was going to ask you a couple of about like, you know, different things you might be interested in doing, but it sounds like, you know, just continuing to make the songs that make people have those reactions is really like the reward in and of itself.
The connection to the audience is the entire reason why I got into music. The connection to the audience, the connection into the fact that, you know, I mean, it was bizarre, like MySpace, you know, hey, the first time I got online, it was really kind of active online, you know, or maybe some stuff, message boards back in the, you know, late 90s or something. But like, you know, it was like, hey, I just thought I'd write you a letter. You know, I was driving my truck out here in the desert and I saw the sun come up and your song came on the radio and it just made me really feel good. You know, and it's just like, I just had an effect on someone's life, you know, for half a second. It was just some crazy song I wrote, you know, in my head. Like I just wrote a beautiful guitar line that kind of sounded like Jane's Addiction, and you know what I mean. Like I was, you know, in many ways I was about ready to tear it down, you know, before it even existed, because I was like, does this sound too much like Jane's Addiction? Does it sound like Dave? You know what I mean? Like that's how you are when you're a musician. You're just kind of like, you know, you've got to have your opinion and your style and your taste. And you know what I mean? It's like, and then years later, you know, 10 years later, there's someone who heard the song on the radio in the desert and saw the sun come up and was driving his truck and he's like, wow, that was really good. Thank you. And took the time to write me that. I mean, you know, that doesn't get old to me. That
right.
The fact that someone's actually going to take the time and just say something like that. And I think that's what, obviously, I think that's what Trent gets out of it, you know.
I guess I have one more question, and I apologize for bringing it back to Trent again, but, you know, it is a Nine Inch Nails podcast. What are you going to do?
It's a Nine Inch Nails podcast.
Indeed. By far the most important question.
We're going balls to the wall with Nine Inch Nails podcasting.
Indeed.
I'm ready. I'm prepared.
All right. Okay, so apparently when he played The Sun Comes Out Tonight, when Trent played your new album, it destroyed his speakers. Did you replace his speakers for him?
I'm sure he just called up the manufacturer and said, I'm Trent Reznor, get this shit up to par. Get this shit up to par. Richie from Filter came in here and destroyed them.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure that was taken care of. Thanks so much for talking to me today. You know, you were a fairly new podcast, so just totally a thrill to talk to you.
Well, hey, I appreciate the interest, and I feel like it's people literally could write a fucking book. I just talk, and I appreciate you taking the time to jot my insanity down, or in this case, record it for everyone to hear so that everybody knows I'm special.
They already knew you were special.
I'm special.
All right. Well, I guess I'm going to.
I appreciate it. Thank you very much. And I can't wait to listen.
Okay, have a nice evening.
Okay, you too.
Bye.